Hi, this is Father Bill W., and welcome to the podcast. I am an Episcopal priest living here in Austin, Texas, and have had the gift of recovery since December the 27th of 1972. Many years ago, I guess it was about 30 years ago, I got real interested in the history of Alcoholics Anonymous, the pioneer program that kind of set this thing in motion. I began studying it, and I quickly was changed by it. And so my interest in these podcasts is to go deeper into three things. One is the history, but I'm not an historian, and also into the psychology, and I'm not a psychologist, and also into the spirituality, and I'm a flawed alcoholic when it comes to that. But, you know, I'm making progress, and that is what it's about. But that's really what the podcasts are kind of centered around, taking people deeper into the recovery process so that we're not superficial and kind of stuck in our recovery journey. Invite you to go and visit our website. It's called Two Way Prayer. And the process of the 11th step, as it was done in the early days of the program, you'll find a lot of information on it there. And I think that's probably enough about the introductory stuff. We are starting a new series, and I was doing my two-way prayer out on the back porch during the summer, and the thought came about the pamphlet, the Oxford Group pamphlet. And whenever I do a two-way prayer workshop, I always reference the pamphlet so that you know that the practice that I'm going to teach is not something that was just developed out there in Southern California and is now being spread on the internet, that it has really, really deep historical roots. And this pamphlet, written by John Batterson, a chaplain, was one of the pieces that really started me going on my two-way prayer journey, because it's kind of hard to find the information in the Oxford Group literature, but here in about a four-page dealy-do, it's laid out very, very nicely. And as soon as I thought about doing that, the next thought that came to my mind was, of course, Wally P. And nobody in the entire universe has done more to spread the gospel of John Batterson around the world more than this fella. So I said, well, I'm going to call Wally, and Wally and I go back quite a ways, and see if he'd be willing to join us in the inaugural flight here and give us some background on who he is and how he got a hold of it and what he's done with it, and maybe even more important, what it's done to him. So Wally, welcome to the podcast. It is great to have you with us. And it's been too long since we got together again. So good to see you, man.
Good to see you, Father Bill.
Yeah. Tell us, Wally, how you came across, a little bit about your recovery, just a little bit about recovery. We're not interested in drunkologues here. But when you got into the history, what was it that attracted you to that? How did you wind up becoming an archivist and interested in the Oxford Group and the early days of AA? And just give us the quick down and dirty.
Okay. In the fall of 1989, with a one-year medallion in my pocket, my sponsor sat me down and said, Wally, I'm not going to be alive much longer. And I was thinking maybe 10 years. He actually passed away 6 weeks after this conversation. And he said, but if you remember this one thing, you'll not ever have to take a drink or a drug or get involved in bad relationships for the rest of your life, whether I'm here or not. And I was waiting for the with bated breath, and he nailed it. He said, if you don't know where we came from, you'll never know what a miracle this program truly is. Now, what I learned from other sponsees, he never said it to anybody else that they were aware of. And he knew I hated history. So maybe that. So I'm a chemist with a master's degree in statistics. I do black, I do white, I don't do gray. I don't need to know the Northern perspective of the Civil War, the Southern perspective, the European perspective. Just give me facts and figures. Mm-hmm. And he knew that's who I was. And he did send me off to learn about the history of the 12-step community. I guess I could have gotten on the phone and called Akron, Ohio, where much of this went down, but I got on a plane and flew to Akron. And while I was there, I was directed to Dr. Bob and Ann Smith's home. Mm-hmm. And I'm there for the one meeting a year that they hold in Dr. Bob and Ann Smith's living room. They've taken all the furniture out and they put in a table, 8 chairs. And it was a speaker meeting. And the only requirement to speak is you have 40 years of sobriety. Mm-hmm. 40. Every person at that table had been sponsored by Dr. Bob. Every person at the table was sponsoring others within a week. And they, to a person, mentioned that relapse was unheard of during this period of time. And that's all I needed to hear. I introduced myself, and they found out that I'd traveled the furthest to go to a meeting that I didn't even know existed in a home that I didn't even know was standing. and then they took me to the kitchen. And first of all, I got all their phone numbers. And then they took me to the kitchen, and Sue Smith Windows, Dr. Bob's daughter, was serving coffee in the kitchen. And I realized that this was not an accident, that this was a divine intervention to get me into that living room at exactly that moment in time so that I could carry the original message of recovery. And I've been doing that ever since.
Now, you were sober how long at that point?
1 year.
1 year. But then you got introduced to the original program and you found a program that was different from the program that perhaps you had been introduced to during that first year. Would that be fair to say?
Well, kind of, sort of.
Kind of, sort of. You started digging in to see how they
did. Not realizing it until I had gotten back from Akron, that I had been taken through the original program by Phil V, my sponsor in Tucson. I came in 88. He came in 68. His sponsor came in 48. And was sponsored by one of Dr. Bob's sponsees.
I see.
So my link is right to the original program without my even knowing it.
I see.
Because again, we did it over 15 minutes in the parking lot, an hour and a half at home, 15 minutes in the parking lot again. So it was stretched out over a few days, but it was less than 4 hours in total.
Mm-hmm.
And when I'm standing in the doorway at Dr. Bob and Ann Smith's home, listening to these 8 people who have been personally sponsored by Dr. Bob, every one of them went through the steps in a day. And I said, oh my God, I was taken through the slow version. Until I realized what's going on today in the rooms. No steps for the first year, 1 step a year, 90 days, meeting makers make it, all this falderall has nothing to do with the original program. So I've dedicated my life to start studying the original program.
Right.
Ever since that conversion experience in Dr. Bob and Ann Smith's living room.
And this led you to the development of the Back to Basics program. Would that be fair?
Yes. The fellowship asked me to write a book on the intergroup and central offices of the 1940s.
Mm-hmm.
And this was in 1992. And I was the Arizona area archivist at the time, so I did have some credentials. But what happened is they wanted me to validate two things. One, that we had a 50 to 75% recovery rate, which is beyond a shadow of a doubt validated. And two, what contribution did the intergroup and central offices make to this 50 to 75% recovery rate? And they put me out for 2 years in the field, going through archival collections here and there, all over the country, United States and Canada. And I did validate the 50 to 75% recovery rate in the 1940s, but I found something called beginners meetings.
Mm-hmm.
And I did not know what was going down there. And except for Earl H., my archival sponsor in Oklahoma City, who went through the beginners meetings in 1957 when he came in, and stayed with them for the rest of his life, presenting them from the podium and taking people through the steps in one day, just like it was done in the early days.
Yeah.
So
Earl, that's Earl Husband, now deceased, but he is the man who turned my life around in the course of about 3 hours. I was in Oklahoma City on some business, and somebody said, "Well, you need to go meet Earl." And I went to Earl's home, and he basically took me through the steps as they were originally done. Of course, there were no steps, but the process. And he got me down on my knees in his living room, taking a third step with him as it had originally been done. I've never been the same since. So I know you and I have that connection going back quite a ways to early 90s or whenever the heck it was. I mean, it was 30 years ago plus. So there you are. So yeah, so you did the back to basics, and you've taken tens of that, maybe hundreds of thousands of people. I don't know how many people have gone through that program, but quite a number.
Yeah, it is over 100,000.
100,000, yeah.
If you take 150 to 300 people every other weekend for mm-hmm. 20 plus years,
right.
Adds up to well over 100,000. But the key is that it's not the work that I'm doing. It's just all these thousands of people that have become meeting leaders, taking their home group through the steps and taking people through the steps at Timmy Hortons or Dunkin' Donuts, wherever they happen to be.
Yeah.
It's just been amazing. 750,000 people have been through the work.
And one of the problems, at least from my perspective, that I see in 12-step world, is people can get stuck on the steps, going over and over and over, rather than going through. And I think that's what was the original intention, was to take you through a process that's going to transform you, and then start living that life transformed. 10, amen. 11, and 12.
Amen, because that's what it's all about. It's not 12 individual steps and you put them in 12 little compartments,
right.
And what step are you on? When right. The old timers heard some of the newcomers coming out of treatment center say, "Okay, old timer, what step are you on?"
Right.
To a person, all of them, we take all 12 steps each and every day. That is a process. We do a surrender every morning, steps 1, 2, and 3. We share with others the things that are bothering us, 4 and 5. We look at the assets as well as liabilities in our life, that's 6 and 7. And then make amends to those we've harmed, forgive those who have harmed us, that's 8 and 9. And then we do the nightly review. That's the whole process.
The way of life. It's a way of life. Yeah. And a part of that way of life is centered in prayer and meditation. And that's what brings us to the pamphlet. Because a lot of people in 12-step world have difficulty with prayer. How do you pray? And meditation. How do I do meditation? And this pamphlet is kind of, I mean, it's so simple, and yet it's revolutionary. So I want to go back to how you first got a hold of that, what you did when you tell us a little bit about Batterson, if you know some of his history, because he's the author of it. Yep. So why don't we start there? Who was Chaplain Batterson, and what was his pamphlet about?
Oh, well, let me back up a little bit before mm-hmm. that, because I do have a Batterson story.
Okay.
Let me tie it into meeting James Houck. I got a phone call in February of 1996 from a lady in Pennsylvania, said she had just come from a convention and had met this guy who was 90 years old and 61 years sober, got sober one day after Bill Wilson, 6 months before Dr. Bob. And I said, no. I mean, I've already been through 30 archival collections, I've already written a book on the intergroup and central offices. His name's not anywhere. So I thought he was senile. So I called him on the phone and asked if I could have a 2-hour interview with him with a tape recorder running. And he said, yes. And I came up with some questions that only somebody from that period of time would be able to answer. And I had 20 questions. As soon as he answered the first one, I put the rest of the 19 away and then listened for the next hour and mm-hmm. 50 minutes, because this is the real deal. And I said, I'd like for you to join me at the Wilson House in East Dorset, Vermont. I'm doing a seminar called The Greatest Spiritual Movement of the 20th Century in March. And I'd like for you to be a co-presenter. And he said, yeah, no problem. Then I called the Wilson House and mentioned who I'd met over the phone. And they said, well, you need to call him back and you need to ask him some more questions. And the first one is, can he walk? 2, does he need oxygen? 3, is he in a wheelchair? I knew what they were doing. And I called James back and I said, I need to ask you some questions. The first one is, can you walk? He says, I can walk a little. Ooh, what does that mean, James? Well, I can walk from my house to my car. Okay, what does that mean? Well, I'm driving to East Dorset, Vermont from Baltimore. It's an 8-hour drive. And he gets there within 5 minutes of his anticipated arrival time. And he brought this pamphlet with him. And it was a turning point in the life of the 70 people who are attending this this seminar. Again, the Wilson House is small. They limit the attendees to 70. Mm-hmm. And James passed out the pamphlet to everybody in the room. And then on Saturday night, this is on Friday, on Saturday night, as I'm getting ready to close the session, he says, give me the microphone, Wally, and handed him the microphone. And he said, I pass this out to everybody in this room and found only 7 or 8 of you actually practicing what's in this pamphlet. Mm-hmm. And that's unacceptable. It's almost 10%, but still unacceptable. Wally, you're going to take an hour out of Sunday morning, and I'm going to conduct an 11-step guidance meeting, just like it was conducted in the early days. And so I clipped an hour out and handed the microphone to him, and I'm standing in the back of the room with a fellow archivist, Mitchell Kay, who is a Clarence Snyder archivist.
Yes.
One of our pioneers. And James put all chairs in a circle, and he's in the middle, and he's got the microphone, and it's all recorded, going back and forth and around the room in two-way prayer and three-way prayer. Two-way prayer is what you hear during your quiet time, and three-way prayer is, again, what you see, feel, hear, or know during your quiet time. And then three-way prayer, which actually came to us from Ann Smith, Dr. Bob's wife, three-way prayer where you hear the voice of God speak to you through other people. Mm-hmm. Whoa. And I'm in the back of the room, and I looked over at Mitchell and I said, do you know what's going on? He said, I don't think so, but I bet this is how Jesus did it. I'll remember that for the rest of my life. I don't know what's going on, but I think that's how Jesus did it. And he did. He changed so many lives in that room. just by practicing this simple four-page pamphlet.
Right.
Just on, as an aside, but it ties into Batterson eventually. Sorry.
Yeah. I got a string around you, Wally. I'll bring you back.
Pull me in. But again, a guy comes up to the microphone and is crying. He cries for 3 to 4 minutes, and then he hands the microphone back to James and leaves.
Mm-hmm.
And afterwards we're saying, he wasn't even part of the seminar. Who is this guy? The next year he comes back and explains what happened. And this is all on tape, both 96 and 97 is on tape, or CD today. He said, I was driving around upstate New York trying to find a place to commit suicide.
Mm.
It was Saturday night, 3:30 in the morning. I called my sponsor and told him what I was about to do. And he said, go to the Wilson House. You'll find your answers there. Mm-hmm. So he shows up at 10 a.m. on Sunday morning, goes to the microphone, cries for 3 minutes, and then leaves. That's what saved his life.
Uh-huh.
Was listening to people share their 11-step guidance. And I'll remember that for the rest of my life.
Well, many, many people, when they first do the guidance, do come to tears.
Yeah.
The intimacy of the voice speaking through them is tremendously powerful and transformational.
Absolutely. And if I see it with my own eyes.
You saw it.
I saw it. Mm-hmm. And in 1997 at the Wilson House, James is in the back of the room and I've got the microphone. So it's part of the process where he led and then he let you carry the message on in your own specific way without any major rules or regulations. Just listen. What do you hear? What do you see? What do you feel? What do you intuitively know?
Yeah.
Wow. And so.
So prayer becomes a felt experience.
Yes.
All right. Not some formula.
No.
Teach me the process.
It's get open, quiet and listen. That's all.
Get quiet and listen. Shut up.
So it's later in 1997 that I am speaking. Actually speaking in Akron, and James is going to be coming in because he's going to be at that same table where these old timers were sharing how Dr. Bob would take him through the steps in a matter of a few hours. So he's got more sobriety than anybody else at the table.
Mm-hmm.
But I came in a week early so I could go down to Ohio Wesleyan in Columbus, Ohio, and go through the Benjamin Forbes collection, which nobody had ever opened the boxes. 17 boxes went in, never been opened ever since. And I opened all 17, spent a week, walked out of there with like 6,000-7,000 pages of material, including Benjamin Ford's guidance books. And this was just a dream come true because I also knew that John Batterson was from Columbus, Ohio.
Mm-hmm.
And I found his nephew. And this is a bittersweet part of the story. Made the appointment, went over, met with him and his wife, had some teenage kids, and we all talked about his uncle. And I didn't record that. That was a mistake.
Yeah,
and it got worse. I do know what I heard. His uncle wrote the pamphlet in 1938. He was already a minister. It was shortly after that he became a chaplain in the military during World War II.
Right.
Okay, written in 38, right. Chaplain during World War II. After World War II, he brought his ministry to a church in Alabama. And the nephew told me the name of the church, the name of the town. I looked it up, got the phone number, called them. And I said, do you have any of John Batterson's material? And they said, oh, well, we did up until 2 years ago, and then we threw everything out. Yeah. So that was a lost piece of our history. And that's part of being an archivist, is don't wait. If you've got an opportunity, take advantage of it immediately, because we just don't know how long everybody's going to be around. He'd already passed away and was just sitting in the back room for a couple of years, and they put it all in the Dempsey dumpster and off it went. And that's a lost piece of our history. But I learned from his nephew that, yes, my uncle wrote the pamphlet. My uncle traveled with the Oxford group all over the country. And that's how James got it. James got it also in 1938 from John Batterson, who was one of the guest speakers at an Oxford group house party, is what they call them. We call them conventions, in Baltimore, Maryland. So that's how he met John Batterson. And he already, in his travels, already met Benjamin Forbes. So there was letters back and forth between Benjamin Forbes and James H. And oh my God, it just goes on and on and on, the divine thread that weaves all of this together. But again, we were able to validate the source of the pamphlet. And between James and I, we passed out close to a million of them.
Are you up to a million now?
Yeah, we're up to a million.
When I first met you, you were in, I think, in the hundreds of thousands or thereabouts.
So I think we were rounding up like Bill. I don't think we had 100,000.
Wonderful, wonderful, wonderful. I do want to. Oh, by the way, for the folks who are listening, in the show notes, we will have a link to this pamphlet we're talking about, so you'll be able to access it, and then Wally can add a few more to his numbers. So we can keep that count going. It's a really wonderful thing. James, you brought James all around the country.
Yes,
he came to Austin. He now James got sober. Is it the day after Bill Wilson?
Yep.
The day after. So that would have been what, December of
12th. December 12th, 1934. Yeah.
Of 1934. He got sober.
6 months before Dr. Bob.
Right. But he gets sober and he gets involved with the Oxford group.
Yes.
And he stays with the Oxford group. And I know Bill met James on a number of occasions.
Yes.
At the Baltimore Oxford group meeting. And he said Wilson would show up and say, "You got any alcoholics around here to work with?" You know, because that's what Wilson was interested in. But James took a different route in his recovery. He stayed sober more through the Oxford group and more through prayer and meditation, and a sincere focus on the stuff that's in that pamphlet. Am I correct?
Oh, absolutely.
Yeah.
He was a master at drawing people out of their shells and getting into the cause and conditions in a matter of minutes, not hours, days,
right,
years. Again, he practiced the principles. What I have here is James Houck's guidance book from 1939 and 1940. This is a temporary gift from Jimmy III, James's grandson. I'm going to copy it and put it out to the world in PDF. We also, right at the beginning of this, this is September 18th, 1939. There's James Houck's fourth step inventory.
Wow.
Assets and liabilities checklist, just like everybody was doing back then. Yeah, there's some real gems in here. It's going to take a couple of weeks to finish over hundreds and hundreds of pages here.
Yeah.
But he recorded his guidance on a regular basis, not for any religious purpose and not for any purpose other than not to forget. That's the way he passed it on. If you write in the morning, you've got something to review at night.
Right. Well, you're going to receive guidance. And if you don't write it down, you will forget what that guidance was. And so to be able to check on it, did I do it? Yeah. I put a little, I always do that with my guidance. I put a check mark. Did I do it or did I not do it? You know, and I got to tell you a little confession on the air here. You know, sometimes I say to Jesus, well, I know better than you. So I didn't get around to that, you know.
Oh, I've got a story on that one too. But again, my guidance, I do a check mark if I've
done it. You do a check mark, good.
Circle if I haven't. And then I take little notes and put them in the margin.
God doesn't yell at me, I discovered. Oh. Have you found that out? You know, it's okay, Wally.
They never love
you
us.
You screwed up a bit yesterday, but we have today.
Yes.
What are you going to do today? You know? Very absolutely forgiving. It's amazing.
Absolutely. And it is, it's not a gotcha God. It's an all loving, all powerful, all forgiving God.
Right. And it's in us. It's
in
us. Religion.
This is basic spirituality.
That's exactly right. I went to visit James at his home.
Yes.
And I will, another confession here. So I'm doing two-way prayer and I'm starting to teach people how to do it. And I went to his home in hopes of getting some instructions from him, some gimmicks. How can I do this better? And how can I, and you know what he said to me, and I'll never forget it. And I was disappointed at the time. He said, Bill, two-way prayer, it's all about the four absolutes.
Yes.
That was it. And over, it took me some years to realize the truth of that statement. It's not about divine inspiration from the beyond. It's all about learning how to love, learning how to get honest, learning how to deal with the impurities in my life, you know, and the selfishness. It's all about that. And if it's not, and that's of course one of the tests, because if the guidance doesn't pass the first test of meeting the standards of or the absolutes,
yeah,
it can't be from God. Just can't be. So the old man was right. Again.
And I'm not sure if he passed it on personally to Bill, but Bill bought in. Again, the Oxford group gave us honesty, purity, unselfishness, and love, mm-hmm, which were the asset side of an assets and liabilities checklist.
Right.
And Bill gives us the liability side of that checklist, having to do with resentment, fear, selfishness, and dishonesty. And he puts it in the big book four times. Twice, right, in step four, once in step 10, and once in step 11. So we get to check which voice are we listening to. That's a Wally P. Are we listening to the voice of recovery or are we listening to the voice of addiction? And now we have a test,
right,
based on whether it's honest, pure, and selfish and loving.
Right.
It usually has to pass all four, or it only has to fail one: resentment, fear, selfishness, and dishonesty. If it fails any one of them, you can rest assured that's ego at work,
right, mm-hmm,
not the voice of the indwelling spirit that's trying to pass on a message of love to all of us.
Yeah, yeah. To realize, God wants to realize him or herself through us.
Yes.
And it makes a difference. And that's basic Jungian psychology.
Yep.
You know, that God isn't some perfect being sitting off in space. God is some being trying to incarnate in ourselves. So when Wilson writes the great reality is within, he ain't kidding.
Yes.
He's not kidding.
It's all in here. It's an inner journey.
It's an inner journey. That's right. And people ask me, well, who are you listening to? Is this God or is it you? Well, I finally got the answer to that. I said, I don't know. If it's me, it's the best part of me I've ever found. And it's a part that has a wisdom that I don't have.
Yeah.
You know? And yet, if I will go to it in the morning and open myself up to the voice and listen, it comes through to me. You know, it's amazing.
It truly is. A statement that I make during the seminars, and for the last 2 years, the Zoom version of the seminars, is that if you are willing to practice step 11 on a regular basis, somewhere along the line, you are going to receive guidance that'll either save your life or put you in a position to save somebody else's life. Mm-hmm. It is going to happen, sometimes quickly, sometimes slowly. And I've got a couple pieces of guidance I'd like to pass on if we have time for it.
Sure.
Okay. Again, this is just one of the many manifestations of my guidance books, but I put some really life-changing guidance in the front. That's why I make that statement that if you're willing to practice this long enough, I mean, I've been practicing it since 1996, and this is 2003.
Right. But so you put a collection, in the front of the book, of the major pieces of guidance that you have received. Okay, that's interesting.
Yeah.
I have a friend who does the process in Germany, and when he goes to a new book, he goes and reviews the old book and takes some of the gems and puts them in the new book. So it's like he's taking his inventory as he moves from book to book.
Beautiful.
Yeah.
So it's 2003. In March, the VA did exploratory surgery and found that I had stage 4 cancer, non-Hodgkin's lymphoma. It was throughout my entire stomach cavity. Mm-hmm. And basically, I got a second opinion, third opinion. Everybody said the same thing, 6 months to a year to live. And they basically just sent me home and, you know, enjoy the last few months of the ride.
Mm-hmm.
So James was well aware of this. James took a different tact. He said, God still has work for you to do, Wally. And as long as he has work for you to do, he's going to keep you around here. So he, she, I like that even better. And I went back. I got 3 opinions. My first opinion was the VA. That oncologist said, do 3 things. Fill out your last will and testament, clean out the garage, and take your last trip. And I did take my last trip to Detroit, Michigan, to say goodbye to the 12-step community. And this, again, is on CD. It's 4:30 in the afternoon. We're getting ready to close up. We've already done step 12. And that's when I made the announcement that they're going to start the chemo on Thursday. That not saying it's going to give me any extra time at all, but I've enjoyed the ride. And you know, thank you for all of your support and prayers. Because I ended up in over 100 prayer lists. And then James comes to the podium after me, and he's 97 years old. He said, I know Wally may not be able to do this, but I am going to carry on his work.
That's James.
That's James.
Yeah.
And he meant it. After doing an 11-step guidance meeting on Sunday afternoon, we all went to the airport, and James got on his plane and flew to Baltimore. And I got on my plane to fly to Tucson via Phoenix, and my plane sits on the ground for 2 hours. Mm-hmm. By the time it gets to Phoenix, the Phoenix to Tucson plane has already taken off, and they put me up at the Hilton Hotel at the Phoenix airport. They don't do that anymore.
No.
The last several years, I've been sleeping on the floor. Yeah, yeah, yeah. But I pack accordingly. Mm-hmm. So I'm walking in the Hilton Hotel parking lot, and I heard the big voice. That's the only way I can describe it.
Mm-hmm.
Inside, outside,
right.
But the voice said, "Do not let the doctors poison you. You were poisoned in Vietnam. Seek non-toxic treatment for the damage caused by Agent Orange."
Mm.
I went back and I wrote it all down, but I mean, it's emblazoned in my memory banks, even though it's on the front page. That was a major piece of information.
Right.
I never would have come up with this on my own. And it is, I've been practicing this since, 96. So this is 7 years in, and I finally get a life-changing piece of guidance.
Yeah. Yeah.
And again, do not let the doctors poison you. I turned down the chemo.
Right.
My oncologist wrote me up as a non-cooperative patient.
Yes.
Refuses convention.
He had that one right, didn't he, Wally?
Oh, absolutely. That chemo, people were lasting 2 to 3 years on that chemo, and that was it.
Mm-hmm.
Whoa. You were poisoned in Vietnam. I went down and at the direction of sharing partners, this is all through sharing partners.
Right.
They told me to turn down the chemo. That's what that says.
Yeah.
Find out if the VA is going to fess up that they poisoned you. Well, they weren't until 2002, but in 2003, they started granting 100% disability to Vietnam veterans with non-Hodgkin's lymphoma. And so I went from zero to 100%, which actually paid for my travels around the world. I mean, I'm subsidized by the federal government to do all this traveling.
Uh-huh. Yeah.
Because there's never enough money to cover it up front. So, but it's all good because it's federal dollars going to help other people stay alive.
Sometimes the voice, when it breaks through into your consciousness, I mean, I know exactly what you're saying. It comes with a power that you really can't deny.
Yeah.
It's different. It's not your ego voice. It's not your usual mind. It's you know, like, well, when Wilson had his hot flash or white light, he knew internally something had shifted. Lois saw it in his eyes, you know, right after. I had mine, and it was so funny, you know, I had it 20 years before I ever got in touch with the Oxford Group stuff. I had it in Ohio, also in Cleveland. I was at Case Western Reserve University, and I was studying to be a Jesuit priest, and I was doing things that Jesuit priests in training should not be doing, okay, you know? we'll just let it go at that, yes. And drinking and drugging were two of the biggest ones. But I was getting ready to run either to Australia and stay drunk for the rest of my life, or I was going to go to India and join an ashram and just become good and holy. And I heard that voice like you heard. And it said, "Bill, you are 27. If those are your choices, there's something wrong with you." And it devastated me. It took my ego and it split it open, which is exactly what I needed. You know, exactly what I needed.
Mm.
And so whereas I had been a runner in the past, in Detroit, this happened, where I was in the seminary, I went back to there and I knew two things about God's will. One was do not drink. That was not God's will for me, was don't drink. And the second thing I knew about God's will for me was don't run. That's all I knew. That's all I knew. But that was enough. That was really enough to get started. And so those words that you heard, they're validated as you go through they become more and more true. You can't question them. You had some sort of an encounter with the divine that spoke to you. Uh-huh.
I don't have any other way to explain it.
No.
Other than it was a divine appointment.
Right.
I showed up to, and I was at the right place at the right time.
Yeah.
Under the set of circumstances.
Right.
That led to the most profound three sentences I've ever recorded.
Right. You wound up writing a book about your encounters with James and two-way prayers called How to Listen to God. I will definitely put a link to that in the show notes. You wrote Back to Basics, taking people through the steps in four weekly sections. And I've done three or four of those. It's just amazing. It doesn't have to take months. It can be relatively fast and intense. If you don't get to the prayer part early in the process, I think we lose a lot of people because of that.
Again, personal opinion, but again, having worked with so many thousands upon thousands of people, people are so hung up on step four, they never get to step 11.
Right.
And that is such a shame, because that's,
I know.
That's where the blessings come.
That's right.
That's where you know that you're safe, you're protected.
Right.
And you're going to be guided to a life beyond your wildest dreams.
Yeah. Wilson was a little bit light in really speaking about the guidance in the big book. I mean, I think he skirts it around it. It's there, but it's almost like it's in code. He didn't want to be part of the Oxford group, didn't want people knowing this was Oxford group. And I think if he said, well, we're listening to God, people would have nailed AA as Oxford group and dismissed it. All right. Did you agree with that? And that's my
take. I do. And there's a hook there that Bill put in that I consider to be just as powerful as anything else he wrote. And that is God consciousness within.
Yes.
That's a quote from Bill W.
Right.
God consciousness within, because that's where the answers are.
Right.
Get quiet. Do a little deep breathing.
Right. Right.
Enjoy the ride, because it's going to be a ride that you're going to look back upon it with that 2020 hindsight. And then you can put the pieces together that this whole thing has been divinely inspired.
What winds up happening, Wally, is the morning quiet time becomes the reality.
Yeah.
People say, well, is that real? As if like the rest of the day is real. No, no, no. This is what's real. The rest of the day, where fear and anxiety and control comes in, that's the imaginary world that you're living in. The only thing original that I've ever kind of come up with is this sentence. I got one sentence that I want on my tombstone. You cannot be where God is not, but you can think you are.
Ooh.
You see, you can think you are. And that's the ego taking you on a trip. Yep. And that's where most of us live.
Yeah.
And that's where most of us live. And so the reality, if you really do this thing right and you do it consistently, you will come to find, and this is what it is in the big book, a part of the mind, that knows and that guides. And that loves, and it's inside of you. Last damn place you'd ever think to look for.
That's part of the problem, is we're looking for a fix out there.
Out there.
Whether it be drugs or alcohol, yeah. Or relationships or the casino.
No.
You can't fix something that's wrong here.
Right.
I'm trying to plug a hole with something out there.
Right.
But it's a perfect fit if you let that indwelling spirit guide and provide.
And each one of our lives is the perfect fit for that spirit. Again, the last place you'd ever want to expect to find God. You know, Jung said, well, those who don't find God, they don't look low enough. They don't look low enough. It's not out there. What are you working on now? You've got the Hauk piece to work on. That's wonderful. You're doing Zoom stuff. Is there a link I can put in the notes on some of your material on how people can kind of track some of this?
Well, my wife is the technical wizard.
All right.
As you found out when we hooked up here.
Yeah.
But I'll send you, we have a Facebook.
Okay. That'd be a good place to get started.
And we have a website. So.
All right. Well, I will put those in the show notes. And that will get people started on it. Well, listen, guy. When I was at a treatment center here in Austin, whenever Wally would come through town, I used to do a recovery communion service for alcoholics and addicts, and he would always try to make it over to that on Sunday night. And then he and I would go out for supper afterwards. So some very happy memories that I have with you, Wally. And I've always seen you as kind of a pioneer program missionary, you know, because you would literally go all around the world carrying the message of the pioneer program and telling people that there's something transformatively different in this. Get to the essence of it. Find out what that is, and it will change you. And it's within the big book, but it's between the lines of the big book, you know? So it's bringing the big book to life is maybe another way to say it.
Or simplifying it to
Point
where just about anybody can understand it, because that was one of Dr. Bob's missions.
Absolutely.
With Clarence Snyder.
Keep this thing simple.
Treat and others was to strip out 95% of the book, which had nothing to do with taking the steps, and just present the 5% of the book that is required.
That's right.
To get from step zero.
Right.
A lot of us are, when we're still out there ripping and running.
Zero is a very important place to begin. Actually, we all have to go to zero, or it ain't going to happen.
But once we acknowledge that we're at step zero, there's hope for us.
Right. We read our scorecards, and it was zero. Well, listen, Wally, this has been, as I thought it would be, a delight to catch up with you again. And I wish you Godspeed in your continued work. I agree with James. God ain't done with you, so
or you. That's why we're here.
Well, yes,
carry a beneficial message.
I retired about 10 years ago, and I've never worked so hard in my life. So I ain't that Florida guy the big book talks about laying on the beach. So I'm staying busy, and it is wonderful, and so thank you, Wally, for coming on. And
my pleasure, good. My friend.
And I want to thank you guys out there for listening. If this was helpful to you, please pass this podcast site on to other people. We've had about 200,000 plays, so we must be doing something right, that people are hungry for deeper spirituality and psychology and history that puts it together in a way that is not simplistic. And I think that Dr. Bob would approve of, because I think we are trying to really keep it simple, get down to the essence identify what it is, and then don't just read it, do it. So
part of the solution.
That's it. It'll all come to life. So once again, Wally, thank you so much. You guys, thank you for listening. God bless, and keep coming back.